On May 17, 1954, the decision of Brown versus the Board of Education was a pivotal point in our lives. Before that, blacks were not permitted to use public restrooms, eat the same counters, or even fly on an airplane sitting next to whites. We vowed at that moment that one day we were going to fly on an airplane. We had a tutor that granted us access to his home library where we studied the U.S. Constitution and the life of Abraham Lincoln. 2 years later, we were boarding a flight on American Airlines to New York City.
On the show that offers the fabulous big prize of $100,000, the show called The Big Surprise. Presented by the Purex Corporation's family of products for your family. Wonderful new Beads O'Bleach. Trend Detergent, the brand the smart girls buy. And new Blue Dutch Cleanser with exclusive Blue Magic action. And here's your $100,000 host, Mike Wallace.
Good evening and welcome to The Big Surprise, the show with a $100,000 big prize. Jack Clark, who is our first big surprise star?
We were the first African-American twins to be televised on a national game show. A national exposure when we went to the State Fair of Texas. That was the only day that black people could go to the State Fair for their activities, and there we were in the twins contest. We won from 1946 until 1952, and that was our gateway to other exposure on the national scene. So we made an application to be on the $64,000 question in New York City. They decided that they wanted us on television very much, and everybody just disloved us. They just couldn't keep their eyes off of us. We came home and they said that they would give us enough time to study. However, they called us back in about 2 weeks and put us on national television. This is when we discovered that there was racism. They were giving the white contestants the answers, but they did not give us the answers for the big surprise.
Well, the Civil Rights Twins became kind of famous in the Civil Rights Movement, because if you worked in the Civil Rights Movement, it was kind of a known reality that these two pretty identical twins from Texas that we call the Civil Rights Twins, and they were in Washington for the March on Washington, which was on August 28, 1963. And of course, Dr. King and Reverend Abernathy spoke about them all of the time.
And when we got there, there were so many people until it was just amazing. The March on Washington made us more determined to fight for civil rights for everybody.
And these gorgeous, gorgeous young women would come and join our marches and risk their lives to be with us.
And then you would read about them in national magazines, so they were almost like civil rights celebrities for us here in Dallas.
Their pictures was in ebony, and everybody wanted a copy. They were a breath of fresh air for the civil rights movement.
Nina and I were chosen among many contestants to model the Silky Straight hair products. Then in 1976, Nina and I decided to wear red, white, and blue afros.
McGee says she and her twin sister became Ali fans early on in his career, but it was her sister's chance meeting with Ali during his visit to Dallas in 1976 that turned them into fans for life. McGee's sister worked for a pattern company, and she had an idea.
And she says, and I have something special for you, and it is a white robe in a Vogue pattern. And I guarantee, if you wear that robe for the Ken Norton fight, you are going to win. And he agreed. And they laughed and they talked further. And she told him, said, you will be our bicentennial man.
We were celebrating the 200th anniversary of America's adoption of the Declaration of Independence. And Muhammad Ali was the symbol of greatness. We were very, very proud.
When you talk about Dallas, and when you talk about going forward in Dallas, they were an integral part of all of the footsteps. These two icons were always present. And presence in and of itself says a lot. Not only were they conscious, but they were courageous. But it was always interesting because they always had the flags. And they were always, regardless of what movement we were in, they were waving the American flags.
I've known the Civil Rights Twins for maybe 25 years, approximately 25 years. And I do recall meeting, I think most of all originally, was really doing a one of our several, unfortunately, police abuse issues where there was undue abuse to one of our citizens. In the late 80s, or should I say the early 80s, Dallas was number one consistently in police shootings. The Civil Rights Twins were very actively involved in that process to help us not only get the signatures, but to stand strong for justice for those citizens who were victimized.
This is not Johannesburg. This is it. I guess we've gotten to the point where we are tired. And what we're about is fairness and justice for all people.
This is not Johannesburg.
Johannesburg. The Rice Twins were actively involved in that process.
We engaged in many projects and movements, whether it was national or local, as long as it was positive.
You know, these ladies have left an indelible footprint. You cannot probably recover any old footage in Dallas and not see the Civil Rights Twins and identify that they were not only part and parcel of the movement, but they were necessary. I don't recall any movement where, you know, their presence wasn't there. They didn't have to garner the microphone, just the fact that they were there.
There's so many different issues that were you name an issue, that's where the Civil Rights Twins have been. And they have been active on the front line for years. You know, one thing also that comes to mind is the issue of the apartheid issue. You know, many years we were doing apartheid in South Africa, we were struggling to like other cities throughout the country, to divest our monies from businesses, the city's monies from businesses that were doing business in South Africa, in order to begin to place the pressure upon the apartheid government, and that was to eliminate any business relations with South Africa. And so we wanted to be a part of that, and we were. And I maintain today that we contributed, the city of Dallas contributed to that movement toward the elimination of apartheid. And of course, the Civil Rights twins contributed significantly to that. Ongoing, it's not just a hit here and a hit there, but the key here in any given struggle is to be consistent. And indeed, the civil rights twins have been consistent toward addressing those issues of injustice.
In the late 80s, I believe it was, the Linnell Jeter case was a very important case in Texas, and then it became a case of national prominence. And I don't know if it was because of their Greenville connection, but I do know how instrumental they were in keeping that in the forefront and really working to get his freedom after he had been unjustly accused and falsely accused. And to know that there would be people who would stay on the case was always so important to us.
There have been so many people who have been the beneficiaries of what the Civil Rights Twin and the movement has really brought to this city. Not too long ago, I saw the Exide plant in Frisco. It's interesting. They now can go to CEQ, the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. They don't have to go through what we had to go through. But when you talk about not only Cadillac Heights, but West Dallas, I think the main plant was in West Dallas, and there were a few people that were standing out there and at that time doing a blockade on those trucks as they were bringing batteries in. I happened to be there with them.
I first met the Civil Rights Twins probably in the early 1980s. We were trying to close 2 lead smelters in Dallas.
Living with lead. Wow. Just the effectiveness of being in a neighborhood, growing up, thinking it's safe, and realizing years later that it was not. The different children that it affected, and families and as a whole that it affected. You know, breathing the air, drinking the water, the health issues that it caused. A lot of people that passed away not knowing that lead was the basic cause of their illnesses and their death. And the twins would came on the scene and joined with some other activists of the neighborhood to rally the people to come out and engage in the meetings to learn more about what this particular company was doing, unbeknown to everybody in their community.
We did our usual work on that, which was a lot of homework. We always did our homework. We probably knew more about lead pollution than anybody in Dallas at that time.
I remember the marches downtown, the different events that Miss Ina and her sister and my mom would come together with, and with flags and just really pulling people in to know what type of danger that they were in.
There were two things that really struck me about the twins, and that was creativity and they had a vivaciousness that put a spark in anything that we did.
Speaking out at meetings, being the voice for the people, a loud voice for the people. A lot of the Hispanic people that weren't able to speak out or really didn't understand what was going on, they were their voice. They were the meat of the community.
And when they would show up to a demonstration, dressed alike, they're very photogenic, beautiful, for one thing, but dressed very nice. Most of us would be dressed, well, I was just dressed raggedy everywhere I go, it seems like, but they would be dressed, I felt, to the nines, as they say, and have a flag. And so instead of being alienated from symbols of patriotism because of being oppressed or left out of things, they reclaimed especially that symbol, the American flag. And so we had the American flag at all of our demonstrations.
I think without their voice, you know, being heard and directing and rallying people, a lot of things that we know we probably wouldn't have known, you know, if it wasn't for them. And so that's very much appreciated.
And I don't believe I've ever met a more enthusiastic warrior for justice than Ina and Nina.
It was, you know, just a sad but a wonderful experience to know that there are people, you know, who set aside and dedicated life, you know, time of their life to help other people. And that, you know, if we had more people like that, that would really be good.
The Civil Rights Twins have been around for almost any civil rights movement that can be put in a history book.
Marches we had downtown Dallas, but not only with the Civil Rights Twins come, but they bring the whole family, the children, I mean, everybody.
Anytime you're with the Civil Rights Twins, anywhere I've gone with them or with Ina by herself, you can always be on the front line because people will make way for her because of her longevity history of being out there fighting for civil rights.
SCLC contacted us to join them in the march on Forsyth County, Georgia. And Nina and I went and joined the march, and there were people there from all over the United States and other states, and states outside of the United States.
And Reverend Jose Williams took a delegation of blacks and whites from SCLC, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, into Forsyth. And we need thousands of us to come.
This is the beginning of a white civil rights movement in this country.
And they were beat up. Jose was almost broke. They threw bricks and bottles at him.
I can't take this world out. We shall overcome someday.
We had to park on the highways, and the Ku Klux Klan was in the trees and in the woods.
And were cursing, saying awful things to us as though we didn't have the right to express our First Amendment rights. But we marched right on that day.
And Ronald Reagan had sent to federalize the National Guard to protect us. And we marched from the outskirts of Forsyth to the City Hall, to the Clark County Courthouse in Forsyth County. But here, leading our marches, leading our demonstrations in these civil rights twins.
We always managed to lead the parades or the marches.
One with the United States flag, American flag, and the other one with the flag of liberation. And that kind of neutralized some of the hatred and some of the mean-spiritedness that our adversaries had for us.
First march was with the Civil Rights Twins right after Congress had passed the Martin Luther King Day celebration. She helped get the celebration together here in Dallas.
I first heard of the Civil Rights Twins through my mother, Lois Louise Washington Miller, and my father, Garland Washington. I always heard them talking about how proactive they were and that they were always at all the civil rights demonstrations. We had SCLC marches. Every Saturday we would have the rallies over at Warren, and then the march that I remember the most was marching into downtown Dallas behind a mule-drawn wagon. I remember that, and Reverend James Orange, who was a national figure with the SCLC, was in town to help us organize and to protest.
So, you know, a lot of people celebrate Dr. King's birthday every year, and they don't know what it took. We marched and protested and marched to get that done. And if you look at those marches, you'll see leading those marches, those gorgeous women. One of them holding the United States flag, another one holding the flag of liberation.
The significance of passing the holiday for celebrating Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday, when black people did not have rights to attend colleges, they did not have rights to sit in go in the front door of restaurants. They did not have rights to vote. Through Dr. Martin Luther King's movement, all of these become significant for black people. So this is why it was so important to get a holiday for this great man who marched. I always like the saying, Rosa sat so Martin could march. Martin marched so Obama could run. Obama ran so our children could fly.
We were always looking for ways to expose others to diverse activities and teaching history.
And then, of course, being twins, they were featured at the Twinsburg Convention.
They were asking for identical twins to be on a television commercial. Nina and I decided to try. And of course, we were chosen to be on the commercial of Big Business.
Business is a hit.
No.
Yes. Hilarious.
This is outrageous.
It's Bette Midler and Lily Tomlin in the comedy Good Morning America Calls a Knockout.
Thumbs up.
Yeah.
We used our status in the community to get the political ear of Bill Clinton.
Now, we had a proactive community development organization called Common Ground. And it was an organization that grew out of the protest movements. And it was one that the twins were quite involved in.
Then Governor Bill Clinton was thinking about running for the presidency of the United States. And he came to Dallas to the Common Ground Credit Union.
Nina worked there as a teller and also just brought that community leadership to the bank. And he was doing his tour and he came through Dallas and he came to the our credit union for a photo op.
17 months ago, when Clinton was only thinking about running for president, he came to the Common Ground Federal Credit Union in South Dallas seeking information and advice from just average folks on what problems they wanted to see addressed.
I remember him saying, well, what are some of the issues you all care about?
Nina Daniels never hesitated.
If you want a pet farm, first of all, have one for jobs. Secondly, stop the crime. Our men are being killed.
And we told him that we were the Civil Rights Twins from Dallas, Texas, and that he was going to win the election.
Listened, talked to others, and now the Daniels have come to enjoy his inauguration, along with the other Yellow Dog Democrats.
They also were very active in the political world, especially with the Democratic Party.
Hello, hello, hello.
It's not hard to spot the Daniels twins. Just look for the ladies dressed in gold. From their hats to their boots, it's their favorite color, symbolic of their favorite state, where everything seems gold.
Highways paved with gold. Texas does.
Does?
Yes, that's why we're the gold queens from the South.
Tina and Nina Daniels are among more than 100 Democrats in the Dallas-Fort Worth area checking in for 3 days of celebration in honor of Bill Clinton. But his election victory was no surprise to the Daniels sisters.
If there was a Republican running or an independent, and you couldn't find a Democrat, and you saw a yellow dog walking down the street, that yellow dog would get our votes.
They understood how politics and civil rights work hand in hand, and they were active in all of those arenas.
As they continue to move through the struggling times, and we're still in those struggling times, but they were more identified during her time, their time. I've seen articles on them where they were raising the American flag. They were taking ownership of their country. But at this early age, in this struggle for civil rights, these two young ladies, the Civil Rights Twins, took on ownership of this country. They let people know that this was their country. It didn't belong to anybody else more than it belonged to them. They understood that they could not sit back and expect other people to do this for them. They knew that they had to do it themselves. We gained a great advantage in the civil rights movement because of the civil rights twins. Also, when we were dealing with the blackest land, the whitest people sign, it was their efforts. It was them willing to bring attention to this sign. Even though there was people who were saying, the sign means no harm, but it had an oppressive nature. And to be a black American at that time, with that sign hanging over your city, it oppressed African Americans. So today the sign is not there due to their efforts along with other civil rights activists.
This history is precious. This history is stained with the blood of our friends. So we must be wise enough and sophisticated enough to make sure we hand this history down to the next generation.
Clinton's first presidential election was the last that Nina and I worked together. At that time, she and I decided that if one twin were to die before the other, the one that was left would continue the struggle.
McGee is one of thousands of Texans flocking to our nation's capital to witness pomp and pageantry. She has tickets to the three-day observation of the 53rd inauguration. But this trip, Ina will travel without her twin. Nina died of cancer in the summer of 95.
Her presence is with me.
But Ina isn't making the political pilgrimage by herself. She invited another sister, Marva Moore, and her cousin, Shirley Daniels.
Oh, I'm so excited. I've always dreamed to go to an inauguration. I've always had an invitation, but never had the opportunity to go.
She was on the front line, and her trademark is the tall red, white and blue American flag and the black, red, and green African flag. And anywhere we went, they always recognized those flags that Ina always carried.
But I took activist Irene Young with me to Greenville.
When we were struggling with the church burnings at Greenville, in Greenville, Texas, and it didn't seem like anything was being done to bring justice to that situation, the Greenville branch NAACP asked for the civil rights twins to come back to their home.
Angry outbursts today in Greenville about the way federal authorities are handling church arson cases.
They're giving you too much credit for something that another organization is doing. Mark Anthony, if anything, he should be sent to a mental institution and treated.
And they was more than willing, with full carriage, with full commitment, to come back to Greenville, Texas, and bring light to the community that was struggling.
The police cannot patrol the community, then it is time to call out the National Guard. It's as simple as that.
Ina McGee, here in Dallas, as you know, as one of those people that was back in the day that really, you know, was in. Totally involved in the movement. She is one of those that believes in excellence, and you can see that in her, and she teaches that to others.
More than 2,000 people crowded into the city convention center, beaming, proud, full of smiles, and full of hope for this man who is facing a huge task. It is a day so many in this city felt they would never live to see.
She is one of those people that you know loves African people dearly through her heart, and she has demonstrated that love. And one of the ways that she did was that she would review newspaper articles, and she would find the most unique articles, or I don't know the word is unique, but the most interesting articles about our struggle and what was going on and what was happening that a lot of us miss. And she always would in on the sidelines related to her family. She would relate it to the things that's going on in her family and her history. But I knew that it was relevant and it was needed. I needed to know this information. And one of those articles that she showed me
that was so important, because as we struggle for reparations, a lot of times people will say, yes, government doesn't, we don't have any money, we're in debt. How are we gonna pay y'all reparations? Well, she showed me an article, whereas the US government has 25% of the world's gold in a vault on the Wall Street.
I took my cousin Shirley Daniels, an activist, to Jasper, Texas, to the funeral of James Byrd Jr.
James Byrd traveled to his grave along the same road where police say he was killed. Jesse Jackson and others traveled to tiny Jasper, Texas to mourn Byrd's passing.
The funeral was in a small church which could not hold no more than 500 people. But Ina was well respected with that flag, and they allowed her to go in. She said, make room for the flag, and we were able to get into the church funeral. We were part of the making of the hate crime bill that was passed from the state of Texas, not knowing that it was going to be a history-making change in the nation.
And I think that's one of the ways we've got to do for our young people. We've got to model by example. They have to see us understanding what a real fight is, a good fight, as the Bible says. Now, I know a lot of us stand up and say that, they fought the good fight and kept the faith. Well, a lot of us don't really know what a good fight is. And they always seem to know what the issues were, and they were always present with the issues.
I want to take a minute to say thank you to the Civil Rights Twins for being just so kind and generous with their time, their money, and their love, to be such an inspiration to all of us, not just to me, but to the Civil Rights Movement, to the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, to SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, to CORE, the Congress of Racial Equality, and to Roy Wilkins, NAACP.
One of the things that I think is that their lives teach us that's so important is that this is a long journey, and that everybody has a part to play. I like to think of it as a relay race. And the twins took the baton, no doubt, from their parents and their grandparents, and they ran their leg of the race. And my generation, we're running our leg of the race. And my children's generation, the generation of the children that I teach, they've got a lap to run. And it's very important for us to understand that we can't rest, because injustice never rests. So we have to keep working, and we have to keep fighting, and we have to keep striving and making our voices heard. And so it's really important for us to study the lives and to know the lives and to know the work and the sacrifice